Praise the Lord. I'd like us to please stand up on our feet as we pray to touch my life, touch my life, touch my life. Hallelujah. Touch my life again, O Lord. Touch my life again. Touch my life, touch my life, touch my life. Oh Lord, touch my life, touch my life, oh Lord. Oh Lord, touch our hearts in the morning. We ask you, Lord, to move ahead with us tonight in the name of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, we surrender to you that you will reveal Jesus to us. And that this man Jesus will increase in our understanding. It will increase in our estimate. It will increase actually inside of us. Every other person will decrease in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. In Jesus Christ's name we have prayed. Amen. Praise the Lord. We thank God for tonight. When we started studying in the morning, I said we are laying some general foundation for actually we are going to be looking at the pure religion. But we cannot get onto dealing with the matter of the pure religion without dealing with the basis of it, without dealing with what actually makes a man to excel in a kind of work with God that God will accept. We said in the morning that if there is anything that contaminates faith, that pollutes faith, that makes faith and religion counterfeit, it is the problem of sin. The problem of that habit of life that we are not bold enough to deal with. But this night, I would like to go ahead and look at the basis of what we call the seed of the pure religion. Pure religion has to begin somewhere. And ever before purity of life, purity of faith, the kind that God is desiring to see in his church, before it can grow anywhere, the seed of it has to be cast. And so tonight, while we continue our study in the book of James, we are going to look at the seed, the basis that leads to pure religion. And I want to begin from that angle tonight so that we can build on it and see the various dimensions as the Lord will lead us in the course of the week. We need to consider what is the basis, what is the seed that produces the purity of faith, the purity of religion in the hearts of men. And maybe the reason why several men are not able to stand the way God wanted them to stand is because the very gene of their faith was faulty, was not correct. So as we look at the scriptures together again tonight, and as we look at the basis of a relationship with God that will bear the semblance of God's expectation, it is my prayer that heavens will be open towards us and that God himself will impart our lives, particularly in the name of Jesus Christ. I would like us to, for our text, read again from the book of James, chapter 1. And we're going to study from verse, you remember we stopped our discussion in verse 16, but this night we'll start reading from verse 17, and we can stop in verse 25 for tonight. James chapter 1, from verse 17 down to verse 25. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Wherefore, lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word, which is able to save your souls. But be ye doers of the word, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholds himself, and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. But whoso looketh into the perfect law of liberty, and continueth therein, he be not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. Let's stop there. May God bless his word in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Now, when you want to grow guinea corn, and you want plenty bags of guinea corn, what do you sow? What do you sow? You sow guinea corn. But when you are intending to get rice, several sacks of rice, and thinking that you are sowing rice, you mistakenly sowed beni seed, what are you going to get? Whatsoever a man soweth, the Bible says, that is what he shall reap. We want to establish very, very quickly tonight as we study that what comes out of the lives of men is a direct result of the kind of seed that have been sown into their lives. And there is no other way, there's no arbitrary way by which we can arrive or attain or practice what the Word of God has referred to as the pure religion, except the correct seed had been planted. Praise the Lord. Except the right seed for the right life had been planted, there is no hope of reaping a kind of life that the Word of God continues to talk about unto our lives. And you will discover from the passages we are reading that God is very, very careful pointing to us that there is a seed that produces the kind of life that God is looking for. And except we give attention to that seed and relate with that seed properly, our lives will only be struggling to attain at the kind of Christian relationship with God or religion that is acceptable before God. Except each one of us, we will give attention to the seed that produces godliness, the seed that produces love, the seed that produces purity. Except we will embrace the seed that can produce the kind of life of Christ within us, every effort we make, everything we try to arrive at a life that is acceptable before God, it will not work out. It will not work out. It will not produce. The seed that produces the kind of life that God is looking for, we have to consider it and give it the pride of place and give it the correct attention it deserves before we can begin to see the pure religion in our own lives, if it is not just going to be a mere effort of man. And so, what we will be doing tonight is first of all to study the seed that produces the kind of life that God is looking for. It is very, very important for us to be sure that the seed that can produce what we are looking for is planted. Otherwise, in vain shall we wait to see the result of a Christian life. In vain shall we be talking and say, look, as a Christian, you are supposed to do this, you are supposed to go here, you are supposed to do that. It will not work. Because the seed that produces such a character had not yet been cast. Or where it had been cast, where it had been planted, it has not been properly nurtured. It has not been properly tended in order to produce according to the will and purposes of God. Praise the Lord. Now, we are going to check some few scriptures along with what we are reading in James before we can return back to settle at the book of James itself. Now, you will notice from chapter 1 verse 17 that we began to read, it said, after he had finished dealing with the fact of the problem of sin, he ended that one in verse 16, said, my dear brothers, make no mistake about this. But every good gift and every perfect gift always comes from where? From above, and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither shadow of turning. Now look at verse 18. It said, of his own will begat he us. With what? With what? With the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. There are two serious issues in verse 18, but we are going to take them one after the other. We are going to study them one after the other, because if we get a good grip of God's purpose for our lives in that verse 18, it begins to become a key unto the kind of religion that God is expecting from our lives. But the first thing we want to study in that verse 18, the Bible says, of his own will begat he us with the word of truth. I want us to read that from Good News. When our brother was reciting chapter of James, it was very beautiful as he was reciting from Good News. Who is having good news? Can you just read verse 18 for us? Yes, sister. It is the word of truth that can make our lives to be transformed and be conformed to the image of the Lord Jesus Christ, such that when you look into our lives, the kind of religion we will practice will be a religion that has been formed, fashioned, arranged by the word of truth. Hallelujah. So we can't be talking about the pure religion until we first of all look at our attitude, our relationship, our response unto God's word, which is the seed for the kingdom life. And when the word of God has not been properly related with or handled in any man's life, the laxity, the emptiness, and the vagueness of that kind of life will become apparent. No matter how you cover it with church activity, it will still show up. It is not activity that is the problem. It is the seed that was not properly planted, or it has not been properly handled, or it is not allowed to grow and shoot forth the way it should. And so whensoever any man is eager to become more and more conformed to the standard of God's will and to live a life that pleases God and to live a life that is victorious, to live a life that portrays Jesus Christ, the only place to go, the only place to return to is still the word of truth, because it is the word of truth by which we are brought into life. Now, when you turn to 1 Peter, let's check 1 Peter chapter 1. Let's check 1 Peter chapter 1. We are going to return to James, but we need all of this to establish what we are trying to talk about tonight. 1 Peter chapter 1, are you there? Are you there? You will quickly, 1 Peter chapter 1, you will quickly read from verse 22. Let's read from verse 22 so that we can save some time. Verse 23 up to verse 25. Obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another with a pure heart fervently, being born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God, which liveth and abides forever. For all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withereth, and the flower thereof falleth away. But the word of the Lord endureth forever. And this is the word by which the gospel is preached unto you. Hallelujah. When you look at verse 22, he said, see ye have purified your souls.
in obeying the truth. The only way by which a man's soul can be purified, the only way by which a man can be sanctified from all filthiness, from all contamination of sin, is by what? Is by what? Is by obeying the truth, which is the word of God. You remember the Lord Jesus Christ said in John chapter 17 and verse 17. Can someone please help us read John 17, 17? Don't worry that we have to read many verses. We need to establish that before we come and settle in the book of James that we need to study tonight. John 17 and 17. Yes, sir. Sanctify them through thy truth.
Thy word is truth.
Hallelujah. Repeat it for us, brother, so that we can follow you. John 17, 17.
Sanctify them through thy truth.
Yes.
Thy word is truth.
Praise the Lord. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. What does that mean? The only thing that can keep a man's heart pure. The only thing that can keep a man sanctified, which is the basis of purity of religion. The only thing that can purify the soul of a man is the truth. The word of truth. The word of God. If you have a husband that is very, very callous, do you know the whole truth of the matter? It is not your fighting him that will change him. Even if you report him to his father had no power to help his life out. There is only one thing that changes a callous man onto a loving man. What is that thing? The word of God. The word of truth. So when you want a man's religion to be pure, to be sincere, and to be acceptable unto God, there's no other way to arrive at such a serious expectation except by the word of truth. Even the Lord Jesus Christ said, sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. In John chapter 15 verse 3, the Lord Jesus again was talking to his disciples. Do you know what he said? He said, you are clean because I washed you with soap. Why? By the word which I have spoken unto you. So ye have become clean by the word that I have spoken unto you. Are you understanding me gradually? That what sanctifies a church, what sanctifies a man, what sanctifies a woman, and what subdues an arrogant fellow, what will make our young people to become very, very sober and very obedient is the word of truth. And the Bible said, and this is the word which by the gospel has been preached unto you. Do you remember what Psalm says? Psalm 119 verse 9 and verse 11. What did he say? Say, wherewith shall a young man cleanse his way? Excuse me, how? How? Say, by taking heed according to thy word. The only way by which a man can live and live well and live above sin is by taking heed unto the word of truth, the word of God. And he said, thy word have I hid in my heart, that I might not do what? I might not sin against you. Hallelujah. When Joshua was to take over from Moses, God said to him, he said, and the book of the law shall not do what? Shall not depart from your mouth. Thou shalt meditate therein day and night. And thou mayest observe to do according to what is written therein. In so doing, you will do what? You will make your way prosperous and you will have a good success. Brothers, the only way by which a man, and that's the first thing I'm laying as a foundation, as a basis for attaining a pure religion, is by the word of truth. It is the word of truth at work on the heart of a man that will make him tender and make him compassionate, and we want to make him share with those that are suffering and those that are in need. Only the word of God can do that. Do you follow me to that point? Are you with me gradually? All right. When you go to the book of 2 Timothy chapter 3, let's check 2 Timothy chapter 3. All these are peripheral passages that shows to us that we cannot expect to reap the life of Jesus Christ without sowing the seed of the word of God. Just as you cannot get rice on a field where you planted guinea corn, so also it is impossible to see the life of Jesus manifest and develop and dominate our lives, our destiny, and our churches, except the seed, which is the word of truth, have been duly planted, duly watered, and duly nurtured, allowed to germinate, allowed to operate. Once I'm able to establish this fact, we will now go on to now focus on that seed, the word of God. How can he help us to produce the kind of pure religion that God will be at home with? Hallelujah. Now, what did 2 Timothy chapter 3 say? 2 Timothy chapter 3, will you please check for us? And if you can read with a good voice, you will read from verse 14, verse 15, verse 16, and verse 17. Please do that quickly. But what?
Continue thou.
But continue thou.
Which thou hast learned and hast been assured of. Know it of whom thou hast learned them. Verse 15. And that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures, which are able to make the wise unto salvation through faith which is in Christ Jesus. All scriptures given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works.
Hallelujah. He said, and I want to amplify it here. If we have other versions, we are going to quickly read that before we can build on what we are, where we are going. He said, but continue thou in the things which thou hast learned and has been assured of, knowing of whom thou hast learned them, and that from a child thou hast known the holy scriptures. If you look at that verse 15 very well, what will the holy scriptures do to any man? Look at that verse 15 very well. What will the holy scriptures do to any man? He said, the holy scriptures which are able to make you wise unto salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. Only the scriptures will make a man wise unto salvation. Only the scriptures will produce in a man the wisdom that leads unto salvation. The salvation that comes to us through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture has been given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine. It is good for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. By the time we come to the end of the book of James, James is talking about what pure religion is all about. He talks about good works. He talks about helping people. He talks about demonstrating the love of God to the poor, to the widows, to the orphans, to the fatherless, and all of that. But you see, what produces that is the word of truth. Are you getting me? What will thoroughly furnish a man and thoroughly prepare him unto all good works is the word of truth that has been sown into his life. And so when the word of God begins to be scarce in any man's life, watch it. After a little time, correct character, correct lifestyle will begin to fail in that life. Are you getting me? Brother, do you get what I'm saying? Sister, are you understanding what I'm saying? If your husband begins to skip the word of God, he begins to be too busy to hear the word of truth. He tells you that he's so busy. You know, he has to go for this business. He has to go for that business. And the word of God is beginning to become omitted in his life. Don't sleep. Don't sleep. Though the financial income into your family may increase, something terrible will soon happen to you. Something uncontrollable will happen. Whenever the word of truth is not given the right of place, correct godly character must become lacking. It is the word of truth that keeps a man from living carelessly. And when that word of God begins to be taken for granted, watch. In a little time to come, you will see strange manifestations. You will see strange character traits. You will see all kinds of things. And you will be baffled. You say, but why did it happen? Why it happened is because the word of truth that produces in man the character of God is no more giving a chance to operate in that life. Are you with me? Are you with me? Now, let us pick 2 Timothy chapter 3 and try to read it a little around from some other versions, after which we will now return to study the book of James. Because the book of James now gives us, what must we do with the word of God in order for that word to produce inside of us the kind of religion, the kind of relationship with God that is acceptable to him and that will bring about a revival in our community. Who will please stand up and read 2 Timothy for us from the Good News Version? And those that carry Living Bible, and if you happen to have Amplified Bible here, will you be able to please help us? Let's go. Good news. Yes, our sister. Try to read with a pastoral voice.
But as for you,
continue
in the truth that you were taught and firmly believe.
Amen.
You know who your teachers were, and you remember that ever since you were a child, you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to give you the wisdom that leads to salvation through faith in Christ Jesus.
All right. 16.
All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching the truth,
rebuking error,
correcting faults, and giving instruction for right living.
You see that now? Wait. He said, the scriptures is useful for teaching the truth, rebuking error, correcting faults, and giving instructions for what kind of life?
Right.
For right living. Yes, sister, go ahead.
So that the person who serves God may be fully qualified.
Yes.
And equipped to do every kind of good deed.
So that the person who serves God may be what? Fully qualified and equipped to do every kind of good work. We cannot arrive at pure religion when we have omitted a proper relationship, a proper attitude to the Word of God. Every time a church wants to get serious about revival, one of the things that God must emphasize is the restoration of the teaching of the undiluted Word of God in that congregation. Churches only die when the pulpits are dead. Praise the Lord. There are no dead churches anywhere. You always make mistakes. Say, this is a living church, this is a dead church, this is a living church, this is a dead church. It's a lie. There is no dead church anywhere. There can only be dead pulpits. When pulpits are dead, when the Word of God no longer goes out from the pulpit, when the undiluted teaching of God's word is no longer sounded with clarity from the pulpit, the pews must go asleep. People in the pews, they will misbehave. It's just like when you plant a farm and you do not weed it. What will happen? It will grow bushy. Any soul that is not being regularly cultivated by the Word of God, it will grow bushy. Any heart that is not exposed regularly unto the Word of truth, error will take over. Any life that is not being exposed unto the authority of the scriptures, the cleansing of the scriptures, not occasionally, not once in a long while, but regularly, there is no way that life can produce the character of Jesus Christ. It cannot. It will fail. What makes a man thoroughly furnished, completely equipped, and properly qualified for every kind of good work is the Word of God. And when the Word of God is not given a chance in a man's heart, let me tell you something, that man, sooner or later, he will misbehave. When the Word of God is not allowed on the heart of young people, watch them as they grow. They will become wild, untamable children. It doesn't matter whether they are sons of preachers, of elders, or of deacons and deaconesses. What makes people reasonable and useful and holy is the word of truth. There's nothing else. So when you ignore the ministry of the word of God to your children, I know maybe you didn't know, you are training their heads, you are sending them to the best of universities, but the thing that can train his heart, that will make him remember you and make him remember his duty in life, both to God and to man, is the word of truth that we have ignored. Any society, any family, any generation where the word of God is not given the pride of place, that generation will collapse. That family will scatter. Those group of children, they will become wild and untamable. It is the scriptures that God uses and is profitable. Hallelujah. I want to tell you that the word of God is what? Is profitable. Very, very profitable. The truth is that you can't live by the word of God and make a loss. You can't submit your soul to the word of God and be a useless man. It's not possible. The word of God doesn't make people useless. The word of God actually equips them and thoroughly qualifies them and prepares them for every kind of good work. And so as we begin to look at pure religion, the seed that produces purity of religion is the word of truth. And our attitude to the word of truth has to be correct. Our emphasis, our premium on the word of God has to be correct. Our priority towards the word of God has to be correct, so that the nature of Jesus might also be reproduced in our lives, in our congregation, in our homes, and in our country as a whole. Hallelujah. Will you please read that same scripture for us from Living Bible? Who is there with Living Bible?
That you can trust those of us who have taught you.
Yes.
You know how, when you were a small child, you were taught of the Holy Scriptures.
Uh-huh.
And it is these that make you wise to accept God's salvation by trusting in Christ Jesus.
Thank you.
The whole Bible was given to us by inspiration from God.
Uh-huh.
And is useful to teach us what is true.
Now, the word of God is useful to teach us what is true. Yes?
And to make us realize what is wrong in our lives.
It is only the word of God that can make us to realize what is wrong in our lives. It is only the word that can reveal to a man the corners of his life that are not correct. You can't get pure religion when the word of truth has not been attended to with all priority. Yes, Auntie.
It strengthens us out and helps us to do what is right.
Wait. Did you see what that scripture says? That the word of truth straightens us out. Did you understand that? That some of us, this is how our life is bent. This is how our life is bent. This is how our character is undulating. The only panabita that straightens people's character is what? Is the word of God. Is the word of God. It straightens us out. Because you know, when you go into the book of Jeremiah, it's my word not like a hammer. It's the word of God, the hammer that straightens people's lives out. If you want a man to be straightened out, if you want a home to be straightened out, if you want a young boy to be straightened out, if you want a business to be straightened out, and the people that are working with you in your company, you want them to be straightened out. You don't want to keep running after those that have embezzled your money. Only one thing can straighten men out, and that thing is the word of truth. It straightens us out, auntie.
It is God's way of making us well prepared.
You have jumped a line, you know. It straightens us out. And
helps us do what is right.
It helps us to do what is right. What helps us to do what is right? It's the word of God. We can't talk about pure religion and right living without dealing with the seed that produces it, the word of truth. It is, yes?
It is God's way of making us well prepared at every point, fully equipped to do good to everyone.
Hallelujah. Thank you. May the Lord bless you in the name of Jesus. Philip's Modern English says, all scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching the faith and correcting error, for resetting the direction of a man's life and training him in good living. It is the scripture that God uses to reset a man's life. Some of us, the direction your life is taking is not good. The direction you are facing, if God does not arrest you, you will run into a dungeon. Yet, there's nothing else that can reset a man's direction except by the ministry of the word of God. Hallelujah. The scriptures, according to this version, says, are the comprehensive equipment of the man of God, and it fits him fully for all branches of his work. God's comprehensive equipment for fashioning a man is the word. Every time God wants to make a man, make him useful, make him very, very resourceful, he must send his word to his life. The more the word of God comes to a man's life, the more God reshapes him, the more God resets his direction, the more God fine-tunes him, the more God produces inside of him a specimen. Where is the Amplified Bible in this church? Yes, auntie?
Okay. And of which you are convinced.
Thank you.
Knowing from whom you learned them.
Thank you.
And how from your childhood you have had a knowledge of and been acquainted with the sacred writings,
mm-hmm.
which are able to instruct you and give you the understanding for salvation, which comes through faith in Christ Jesus, through the leaning of the entire human personality on God in Christ Jesus, in absolute trust and confidence in his power wisdom and goodness.
Thank you.
Every scripture is God-breathed, given by his inspiration, and profitable for instruction, for reproof, and conviction of sin, for correction of error, and discipline in obedience, and for training in righteousness, in holy living, in conformity to God's will in thought, purpose, and action, so that the man of God may be complete and proficient, well fitted and thoroughly equipped for every good work.
Thank you. Thank you. God bless you. He said the word of God is profitable for discipline in obedience and for training in righteousness, for training in holy living, in conformity to God's will in thought, purpose, and action. If your purpose, if your action, and if your thought will be in conformity with the will of God, what will bring that to pass? What will bring that to pass? Only the word of God. Let me again repeat to you. Some people come to church either for social reason. They just want to belong. They want us to have their names on church register. But they do not give attendance unto the word of God. They don't have time to come for Bible study. And even when they come to church, they are more satisfied with ceremonies than the word of God. We don't have any hope in such a people. They cannot but misbehave, because the thing that resets a man's direction is what they have omitted. Those church members that have no space in their time for a consistent teaching and learning of the word of God, I am afraid if they really will have time to go to heaven. The things that fit a man for the sky, for heaven, is the word of God, is the word of truth. And when the word of God begins to diminish in a man's life, when the word of God begins to reduce in a man's consideration, when the word of God begins to be squeezed and packed to a corner in your time management, you are entering into a crisis. Things will soon scatter. So we will return now to the book of James. I took all this time looking at what the word of God was meant to accomplish in order for us now to appreciate the practical instructions that the book of James now gives about what we produce a pure religion in our lives, which is by a correct attitude towards the word of truth. Can we now return to James? We are still in verse 18. Now, James chapter 1 verse 18 says, of his own will begat he us with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Excuse me. I'm praying that God will cause you to understand what God intends to make out of our lives as we give attention to the word of God. Some people think, and this is an erroneous thinking, it has affected the church a lot. Some people think that if you give yourself so much to Bible study and to the practice of the word of God, you are going to likely be a dropout among your colleagues. This is the devil. Some of us imagine that the time we spend with the Word of God is a wasted time compared with the time we could have put into our business. This is the deceit of the devil. It is the devil that wants to rob you of something that God wants to make out of your life. I would like us again, as we are going through different passages, different versions, we will read that verse 18 once more. And please permit us, this is a Bible study time, because if we don't take time to look at the Bible, I wonder what will make us arrive at pure religion, the kind that our heart desires to have as believers. Go back to verse 18. James chapter 1, verse 18. We have been reading it from King James. How did New King James put it? Who has the New King James? Verse 18. The New King James. Yes, sir. He did what?
He brought us forth by the word of truth.
By his own will, God brought us forth by the word of truth. Yes.
That we might be a kind of first fruits of his creatures.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. Praise the Lord for that. So where is good news? What did good news say? James 1:18.
By his own will, he brought us into being.
He brought us. Now, sister, come small so that we can follow you.
By his own will.
Yes.
He brought us into being through the word of truth.
Yes.
So that we should have first place among all his creatures.
Oh, may God grant you understanding. Do you understand the meaning of that? Amen. Did you see what God is saying? He said, of his own will, he has brought us into being by the word of truth, that we might, each one of us, have the first place among his creatures. Maybe we should read it from other versions so that we can have an understanding of what God wants to produce in our lives by the word of truth. The kind of man that God wants to make out of you by allowing the word of God to be pumped into your life. By allowing the word of God to be sown into your heart. That's something God wants to produce among men. That scripture says, of his own will, as he brought us into being by the word of truth, that we may have the first place among all his creatures. God is intending that every one of us that has been brought into life again by the word of truth, he never plans for us to be behind. Hallelujah. What was his plan? That we will have the first place. Let me tell you something. Whensoever the word of God is working in any man and it's given the right place, and the word of God has been given a chance to work in a man's character, when he goes for any interview, when they are looking for correct choice, the plan of God is that you will have what? The first place. When they are looking for intelligence, good management, thoroughness in planning and executing of programs, the plan of God is that those of us that have been exercised unto the word of truth, we can all come second.
The plan of God is that Christians that have been taught in the Word of God, they will be the first and the best among all His creatures. Hallelujah. As a teacher, if you have been instructed in the word of truth, no matter where they carry your upper form, the truth of the word of God ought to produce the best of personality inside of you among all your equals. So when we talk about the word of truth, it is actually capable of producing the best among men. When they bring families together, God intends that the family of His children that have been exercised continually in the word of truth will be the first and the best in a community of families. Are you understanding what I'm talking about? Whensoever you give the word of God proper place in your family. Now, look in the community among many families. Except something else went wrong with your understanding of the scriptures, your family ought to be the best. Men ought to be rushing and say, if anybody comes from that family, we know you will be the best among their classmates. That's what the word of God does to produce. Where is another version? Where is the Living Bible? Verse 18. And it was a happy day for him when he gave us our new lives through the truth of his word. And we became, as it were, the first children in his new family. Hallelujah. Now, I'll read it from Philip's English, Philip's Modern English, and you will see what he said. By his own wish, he made us his own sons through the word of truth, that we might be, so to speak, the first specimens. What was God planning for you to become? The first specimen. God intends to make you a specimen among men. You see, when we talk about pure religion, the truth is that wheresoever the word of God had been applied, you ought to become a specimen. You ought to become a life among all men. And you know this thing that we are talking about, whether in academics, whether in your profession as a lawyer, as an economist, as an industrialist, in whichever calling you find yourself, the plan of God, when He brought us forth by the word of truth, is to make you the first specimen. Hallelujah. It is a pity that we have so many people that bear Christian names. They are in government and they are not specimens. You know that something was wrong with their lives. Do you know why? They have omitted the word of God. The plan of God for every man that He has brought to Himself is to make him the best among all around him. God has not yet lost that vision. No. As we submit ourselves to the truth of the word of God, He will produce inside of us specimens. He will point at men and say, have you noticed my son Job? You know that when God was pointing at Job, He was pointing to him as what? As a specimen Have you seen Joe? Hallelujah. And do you know when they were pointing at Job? They were not only pointing at Job just because of his righteousness. Job excelled in righteousness, in family life. He excelled even in business. To such a time that the devil said, hey, how will Job not serve you? When you have blessed him roundabout. When everything about him is going smooth. It's only the word of God that produces such a thing. My prayer this night is that the seed that produces the kind of kingdom life, which is the word of truth, we will never ignore it. In the name of Jesus Christ. But what then is the right attitude to the word of God? What then must be my approach, your own approach, unto this seed that can make you great? Each time you tell me that you are too busy to attend to the word of God, I am very, very afraid, because I don't know what else we straighten your situation apart from the word of truth. I don't know what else will change the condition of your family life apart from the word of God. I don't know what else will make your children to become correct children apart from the word that is written in the Holy Scriptures. So what must be my attitude unto the word of truth in order to arrive at pure religion? So go with me to verse 19. You see, verse 19 said, wherefore, what's the meaning of wherefore? As a result of this, consequent upon this, because of this thing that we are talking about, because the word of truth is God's own comprehensive equipment to produce inside of you a specimen. When housewives come consistently for Bible studies, hallelujah, and they allow the word of God to take place in their lives, you know the results we have always discovered? We have discovered their husbands coming secretly and say, what did you do to my wife? She has changed. Hallelujah. A man used to beat his wife regularly. You laugh at the word regularly. And when the wife became a child of God and began to be exposed to the word of God, her character so changed, even though the man had never yet repented. This man now will carry his wife in the car for Bible study and drop her and will go back and wait for the closing time to come and pick her. One day, the word of God arrested the man. And as he was giving his testimony, he said, this thing has benefited him, because it has brought deliverance to his home. His wife has become such a treasure. He's no more afraid that his wife will mismanage their family finance.
And he couldn't resist coming to find out what has brought this kind of change. And he also has changed. He carries Bible everywhere now. When we expose the word of God to any life, you become a specimen. You become the first among your equals. Do you know that the business that you are running that is scattering? It is because you've not yet sought the wisdom of God embedded in the word of truth about running that business. That's why everything is scattering for you. James said, because of the centrality of the word of God to make us specimen among the creatures, because of the efficacy of the word of God to change a man's life and make him a blessing to his own generation. Beloved brethren, verse 19, let every man be what? Be what? Be swift to hear. Hallelujah. The first attitude, the first correct attitude to the word of God, if you are going to arrive at God's expectation of making you a specimen in your profession, a specimen in your community, a specimen in your life, a specimen in your family. The Bible said, let every man be swift to do what? To hear. Be swift. Be urgent. Be zealous to hear the word of God. Because faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. It looks as if the only way, the correct attitude we must put to this seed, the word of truth that can change our life, change our community, change everywhere, is that we must be eager to hear it. Our attitude to hearing the word of God must be that of zeal, must be that of excitement. We must be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. When it comes to hearing the word of God, how must we do? We must be swift, must not be sluggish. We must attend our ears towards the wisdom of God in his word. If there's anything we run to hear, it should be the word of God. If there's anything we are quick to pick, it is the word of God. If there's anything we say, Lugo, I must not miss, it must be the word that comes from the mouth of God. Why did he say we should be slow to speak? Many times, when a man has not assimilated the truth into his life, he only makes foolish comments. A man with an empty heart, he can only speak vain and empty words. When the word of God has not saturated your heart, much of what you are saying will be rubbish. When the word of God has not governed a man's heart, much of his utterance will be rash and ordinary babbling, uncoordinated talk. Most of the time it is vain repetition of jargon. Brother, I wonder what you are speaking about when you have not first of all taken instruction from the word of God for your day-to-day living. I wonder what you are running up and down for When the word that will have guided your feet unto success, the word that will have made your way prosperous, the word of God that will have granted you good success, you are not eager to understand it. You are not eager to grasp it. What else will you then grasp? How will you go in life? David said, "Thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path." Can you imagine that? They discover that the word of God is the lamp that lighting where they will place their feet. Hallelujah. And it is the torchlight that shines the light on their path so that they will know the road. And I thank God for the beauty of the word of God. It comes as a light. It will lighten your path. You will see ahead. But for the immediate step to take, you still need another light, which is close enough, like a lamp. He said, put your feet here. Don't place your feet here because the devil has dug something here. Jump over this. Come this way. Only the word of God can guide a man like that. So what is the first attitude that the word of God is saying we should have towards the word of truth? We must be swift to hear. We must be swift. When we wake up early in the morning, we say, Lord, what do you have to say to me in your word today? What do you want to say to me in your scriptures today? And as a man continues to seek to hear, his life can never be a waste. Verse 21. Wherefore, that's another wherefore. Consequent upon this, do what? Do what, please? Lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. Other version says, overflow of wickedness. I think Revised Standard Version says, therefore put away all filthiness and rank growth of wickedness. Hallelujah. When you see that, that's a very technical word, rank growth. It is only in statistics, when we are analyzing a data, you now start talking about rank. When a data is so big that you cannot analyze it one by one, you now again subdivide it into what we call ranks. You now study it by ranks. And the scripture is saying here, look, lay apart, put aside all filthiness and rank growth of wickedness. That other version says superfluity, something that has become superfluous, something that has become so much. It said, lay those things apart, forget about them, and do something. What did he say we should do? Receive. Receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. Hallelujah. Permit me to look at verse 21 a little closely before we can leave it. Apart from being swift to hear the word of God, which is the first condition, because you see, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Hallelujah. A man that does not hear, there's no way he can believe. The first obstacle to overcome is that thing that takes you away from hearing the word of God. That thing that occupies you from hearing the word of God. That thing that tells you, look, you are too busy to hear the word of God, is the first obstacle, because those that do not hear, they cannot even take decision. Their faith cannot even be formed.
So that's the first thing. But you see, hearing is only but one step. It is a necessary step, but it's not a sufficient step. Praise the Lord. It is not sufficient to hear. The second thing the Bible says we must do in terms of our attitude unto the word of God, that will produce in us the kind of specimen life, specimen personalities that God is looking for in our generation, is to receive. Some people hear, but not many receive. What does it mean to receive? Who can give us another word for receive? Accept? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. What did you say, sir? To embrace. Thank you. To embrace. To usher in. Thank you very much. That's another good word. Uncle? To engulf. That's a higher word than receive, you know. Hallelujah. That's good. To engulf. To embrace. To welcome, to grab, to allow in. To imbibe. He said, lay apart. Excuse me. If you want your life to make meaning, lay apart all filthiness. What does filthiness do to a man? It only destroys him. The kind of thing that you allow into your heart is what you will eventually become. Lay apart all filthiness and superfluity of naughtiness. Naughtiness. Things that just makes you naughty. Put those things aside and receive with meekness. Embrace with meekness, not with argument, not with pride. With meekness. But you see, I still have another word to deal with here before I can leave verse 21. If he just said, receive with meekness the word of truth, that would have been something easier for us to go and quickly move away from. But he said, receive with meekness what? The engrafted word. That's something, that's the third attitude. Not only to receive, what must we do with the word of God? What must we do with the word? We must engraft it. What does it mean to engraft? There are some agriculturists here. Will you not help us now? Implanted. All right. So we could use the implanted word. All right. Is there any other way to explain the word engraft? At journey. Help us. To board. What does it mean? Help us. We don't know these things. You collect another tree. Yes? All right. So how do we do it?
you must get a pure branch, not contaminated. All right. Uh-huh. Okay. Yes. Yes. Okay. All right. Thank you, sir. God bless you. Praise the Lord. Did you understand what he has said? You see, this is a teaching class, so we have to learn from one another. When you engraft, there is an old stock that is growing from ground. But if you allow that thing to keep growing, it will produce for you something useless. Eh? All right. So what do? You cut off his own branches. Then you go and get a correct, a good species, the kind you are looking for. Eh? After you have cut off the native branches, the one that if you are allowed to keep growing, it will only produce for you wild plants. You cut it off. You now come with the new branch, fresh, uncontaminated. You come and place it on top of these branches that you have cut away. And you tie it very tightly. And you hold it in place until they glue together. And then it will now begin to grow for you something better. Excuse me, sirs. Your original life is a white plant. Your original idea, the one that we got from our fathers, is a useless way of life. Those ideas, if you allow it to keep growing, it will only produce a wild, untamable plant around your life. When the word of God comes, that is the pure word. That is the original plant. That is the good seed. That is the one that will produce the fruit that many people around you are looking for. What do you do with that word of God now? You come and engraft it on your life. To engraft, you must cut off the native branches and put on top the new branch and hold it tightly in place until it becomes glued upon the old stem, and then you can get something good. Do you understand what we're talking about now? So how do we engraft the word of God on our lives? Number one, the word of God must supersede your personal opinion. It supersedes what you have been building over before. It supersedes what you have been looking and living upon, your principles, your ideas, your native wisdom. They cannot carry you and produce any genuine fruit that can take you to heaven. So when the word of God comes, we engraft it upon our lives. We engraft it upon our character. We engraft it upon our native ideas. And we hold it tightly. We don't allow it to shift. We don't allow it to fall off. We hold it until it becomes part and parcel of our lives. That's how to deal with the word of God. Number one, you must be swift to hear it. Hallelujah. Number two, you must do what? Receive it. When you have laid apart all filthiness, superfluities of nothingness, you now receive it, embrace it, engulf yourself into it, imbibe it. And then when you have received it, what do you do with it? Engraft it. So many people have been reading, they have been coming for Bible study, they have been listening to the word of God. When they hear, they say, Kai, that's a good message.
And as they shake their head like this, they shake it away. They say, well, what the man is preaching is true. It's true. But you know, let's face reality. I want to ask you, what reality is there outside the word of God? What reality are you talking about except you just want to be foolish? Outside the word of God. Only the word of God can produce reality in the life of any man. So in order to grow a pure religion, we must engraft the word of God over our native life, our native ideas, our tradition. The word of God must supersede. It must be superimposed upon your life, upon your custom, upon your tradition, upon that which you have been growing up with for years. When you see the word of life, that is the correct seed that will produce the correct fruit in years to come. Hallelujah. And look at the conclusion of that scripture. The engrafted word, which is what? It is able to, and it seems to have uprooted so many things that you have been holding tightly to. It only does that so that your hands can be free to collect something better from heaven. If the word of God came and it seemed to have shaken out from your life several native branches, it is because those branches, they appear good to you today, but God saw the end of it from the beginning. God saw that they will only produce thistles, white grapes, bitter things it will bring to your life. God said, let me shake it out. Let me replace it with my own ideas. This night, the word which is able to save your souls. What again must then be our attitude? Can you please recant where we have reached now? What is the first attitude, please? Be swift to do what? To hear. Because what you don't hear, you cannot know. Is that not so? He said, how will they believe if they do not hear? For faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Until you hear the truth, you have not even started. One of the greatest weapons the devil uses to keep men in bondage is ignorance. And God's first therapy for deliverance is knowledge, the knowledge of the truth. Hallelujah. So you must be swift to do what? To hear. Number two, receive. Please receive, become receptive. Open the door of your heart and welcome the word of God. Welcome the word into your heart and say, Lord, I want to receive the word of God. I want the word of God to mix with faith inside of me. I want to imbibe the word. I want to be engulfed in the word. I want to embrace it. Yes, number three, what is it? Engraft it. Engraft it. Allow it to replace your character. Let it replace your native character, your tradition, your culture, your old habits, your old friendship. Let the word of God replace them. It will produce for you something better, something more durable, something more eternal. Praise the Lord. Now, number four, the fourth attitude that will produce the pure religion, that will make you a specimen. And I'm so eager that God will produce inside of several of us specimens for this generation, specimen for this nation. Hallelujah. A revival was taking place in a particular place, and the Lord was moving so much that in a particular church where the word of God was coming, people's lives were changing. And so there was a brother from that church who was a customs officer or one of the policemen of that country. There had been a problem in the customs service. The country did all they could to eradicate corruption and problems. It couldn't work. Anybody they posted there was corrupted. Until this brother got into that place. And the authorities, they noted him that since he came, things went well. So they now called him for a special interview. They asked him and said, "What made you different from all the people we have posted to this place?" And he said in a simple word, he said, "Because of the way I have been brought up." Say, "Who brought you up?" Say, "My pastor." That's how government authority came to the church, interrogated the pastor and said, "What do you do to this kind of people that you produce this kind of man? We've been looking for honest men until we find this man." And he said that it was you who brought him up. "Can you please release some of your members to come and take up positions and jobs? Let them help us repair the customs service." Are you getting what I'm talking about? That's how, without any further interview, anybody that the pastor pointed at was just appointed. And they placed them in positions. You see, because revival has produced specimens. You see, the kind of Christianity we practice in Nigeria, that if you are doing business with a Christian brother, is more dangerous than doing business with a non-believer. Abi? If you want to buy something and a brother says, "God bless you, bro. God bless you. Please sit down and take a bottle of Coke." Be careful. As you are doing that, you know you won't be able to price market anymore. Say, bro, praise God, bro, it's for you. And he will have cheated you 50%. What makes Christianity of our own time to look like that? There was an omission of the undiluted teaching of the Word of God. The Word of God ought to produce specimens. It bothers me when a Christian is employed and your employers will have reason to complain that you are lazy. Your employers will have reason to say that the Bible didn't carry. I can't see anything he has done. That is an insult upon the scriptures we preach. It's a very, very terrible insult upon our God. It's like the man that God is boasting about, they don't even meet up with the standards, the minimum standards of this world. It's not correct. Get ready to receive the word. Let the word reproduce inside of you. That's what we are calling pure religion. Practical Christian living. Lies that you cannot fault. Carry them to anywhere. Even when people decide to tell lies, their conscience will still be telling them that, "But you're only deceiving yourself. This man is not like that." Hallelujah. Receive. Embrace. Open up. Then the third thing, engraft. Abi? So what is the fourth thing? Verse 22. "But be ye what? Doers of the world. That is number four. We are noting four serious responses that we must give to the Word of God so that God can get a kind of specimen out of our lives and out of our midst. He said, be ye doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Brother, any man who hears the word of God only and does not become a practical doer of the word that he has heard, the Bible simply said he is a deceiver. First, he's a deceiver of himself and a deceiver of all those who believe in him. Praise the Lord. Let me say again, for us to progress, for us to arrive at the desire for revival, it is of necessity, you know, there has to be an increased obedience unto the word of God. Anywhere you see the move of the Spirit, a genuine revival, it is simply because people became more committed to hearing the word and they became more committed to doing the word. When people increase in their obedience to the word of God, the glory of God surely must multiply in that place, in that life, in that family, and in that community, and in that local church. Be ye doers of the word of God, and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. For if any man, and I want you to hear this before we finish, if any man be a hearer of the word, and not a doer, and I do pray that as I conclude our discussion from this Bible verse, you will need to consider this very seriously tonight. If any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholds himself and goeth his way, and straightway forgetteth what manner of man he was. My brothers, do you know that the truth of the matter is that you have heard enough messages in your lifetime that could have made you the best that any man can be? Eh? Eh? But what is the problem? If we have only acted on even 10% of every message we have heard, the power of God will have overflooded our lives. But because majority of men are hearers, there are more majorities that don't hear. But then, there are majorities that are hearers only. There are very, very few doers. If after this night, the Lord begins to help you to act on the word of God, and you decide, I will do it. Whenever I discover the word, I will engraft it. Anything I found out in the word of God, I will cut off my native branch and put it on top of it. And I will glue myself to God's word until it becomes my life. There's going to be greater result, greater revival than we have ever expected or seen in our several years of service. But I want to stop here because this is where we should stop for tonight, so that we can pick off the matter of pure religion from this point. I will be looking at the manifestation of a correct life when we gather back here. But look at the analogy that the Holy Spirit is bringing for a man that just heareth the word of God and not a doer of it. Such is a man who is looking at himself in a glass. And can you imagine, anytime you pick the mirror to look at yourself, if it's a good mirror, what does it do? What does it do? It shows you yourself. No distortion, no enlargement, no reduction. Everything just as you are. If it's a plain mirror, I'm not talking of concave mirror. I'm not talking of convex mirror. Are you getting me? I'm not talking of magnifying glass. I'm talking of plain mirror. Your dimension is the dimension it will give you. And that mirror has a power of making you to face yourself. Do you understand? It will turn you by lateral inversion so that you can face yourself. You will see yourself by yourself. But the moment you put the mirror down, what happens also? Eh? Can you remember how you looked? No. All of us may have looked at the mirror before we came out. But if I ask you to describe to us how your hair appeared, can you remember? You have forgotten. There's no way to keep the word of God except you practice it. You see, I'm happy when we write notes as we're listening to the word of God. That's good. It's a good thing to encourage. But it's not enough. Until you act on the word of God, you have not got it. Until you obey the word of God, it can't stay with you. It doesn't work until it has worked. It doesn't stay until you have acted on it. And why James was likening it to a man who looks at himself in the mirror and forgets himself and goes his way, and he returns to his vomit. Jesus had a stronger illustration in Matthew 7. And so let's conclude as we hear what Jesus says about those who hear the word in Matthew chapter 7. Can you please join me as we conclude with that? In verse 24, Matthew 7:24. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them. Emphasis on what? Doing. I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. Please note this, because this is very crucial for us to pray with. And the rain descended, and the winds came. And the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon that house, and it fell not, because it was founded upon a rock. The only way to prepare against storm is to listen to the word of God and to practice them. The truth is that rains will descend. Floods will come. The Bible says, and the enemy came. When the enemy comes like a flood. Do you remember that? The Bible said, the Spirit of the Lord shall raise a standard against it. You kept wondering, what is the standard that the Spirit of God raises against the floods? Is the word of God. The word of God is the wedge that does not allow a man's life to be swept away. The word of God is that wedge that holds our lives against flood. Left to the devil, he would like to flood some of us out. He would like to bring so many things at the same time to flood our lives with confusions and problems. But a man that is acting day by day on the word of God, he has a standard against floods.
Say, and the winds blew and beat upon that house. Looking at that scripture, it gives you a sense as if the winds had nowhere else to go again than to come and beat upon this house. Beat, and there are times, brothers, when the devil will concentrate all his winds upon you. When it will look as if you are the only man that the devil wants to uproot, he will send all his winds. Winds, terrible storms, all kind of opposition. As he's beating you here, beating you over here, beating upon the house. But you see, because that house was founded and foundated upon the word of God, the Bible says it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them not. I will liken him unto who? A foolish man. And you see, whereas in verse 24 he said, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine. But in verse 26 he said, everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doeth it not shall be likened unto a foolish man. Every man who does not do the word of God is a foolish man. That's what Jesus said. Which built his house upon the sand. Brother, to hear the word of God and not to act on it is like building your destiny upon sand. It is like building your eternity upon sand without foundation. Said the rain descended, the floods came, and it is coming. And the winds blew and beat upon that house. And what did the Bible say happened to the house? It fell. It fell small. Part of it fell. And great was the fall of it. If our lives will not fall off, if your destiny will not be swept away, if your ministry will not be swept off, if the things that are happening and things that will happen in the coming days, because one of the things that will characterize the next century, if the Lord Jesus tarries, will be floods of wickedness. It will be much more than we witnessed. But you see, the beauty of it is that it is in the midst of that that God will prepare a people that can stand out in the beauty of holiness, a church without spot or wrinkle, a church that is standing and saying, we belong to the Lord, we live by the principles of righteousness. But the flood will be much. If you discover now that in several parts of the world, homosexuals, they are not ashamed of it. They even have their own reverend pastors who join man to man. They officiate. Terrible things that you can't imagine. Young children are growing violent. And it's like it is a crime for you to challenge their thoughts. All of these are happening. And they will yet happen more. Floods will come. Many lives will be uprooted because they are not acting, they are not properly foundated upon the word of God. This night, my question is very, very clear. And I just want to put it to you as we pray together. The seed that can produce the kingdom God, the kingdom life, the seed that can produce pure religion, the seed that can make you to live a life that is acceptable before God is the word of truth. The seed that keeps a man from sin is the word of truth. The seed that sanctifies is the word of truth. The seed that straightens us out is the word of truth. the seed that establishes the purpose of God in a man's life and make him thoroughly furnished and fitted for every kind of good work. The seed that can turn you to become a specimen among your colleagues and equals is the word of truth. The seed that can give you a profitable family is the word of truth. The seed that can make your children very, very dependable so that they can remember you at your old age is the word of truth. And this same word, the Bible says, is what is being preached to us by the gospel. What will be your attitude to it as we pray tonight? What will be your response to the word of God? Have you been hearing the word of God and you've not been acting? How I pray that the Holy Spirit will remind you tonight how many times the Lord has spoken to you and you did as if you were going to obey, but you did not give obedience. And yet the Bible says obedience is better than sacrifice. To hearken is much more preferable to God than what? The fat of rams. As we conclude for tonight, pure religion is not possible except the word of truth has been given the right place. Purity of our faith cannot happen except the seed that produces such a lifestyle has been duly planted, properly watered, and meticulously obeyed. Then we cannot see the glory that God is talking to us about. As we pray together tonight, as you present yourself to God, he said, be swift to hear. Be swift to hear. Be slow to speak, be slow to wrath. But when it comes to hearing the word of God, do that very quickly. Do that with all your strength. Do that with all your ability. Do that with every wisdom that God has given you. As we call on God tonight, one thing I would like you to check. It will not be correct to go out with a labor of a fool. Say, whosoever heareth these sins of mine and doeth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man. There's no need for God to look at you and say, this is a fool. There's no need for the Holy Spirit to say, this man is a fool. He has heard me, but he's not going to act on it. As we plead with God together tonight, will you need to check areas of your life where the word of truth has not been engrafted? Where the word of truth has not restrained you from the life of sin? It says, sanctify them by thy word, for thy word is truth. Will you check as we plead together? Because as we're aiming at a great move of God, a revival that will produce the kind of church, the kind of Christians that God is waiting for in heaven, we are discovering that we can't do it without the undiluted teaching, hearing, and practice of God's word. We can't. And it won't pay us if all we do is to hear and we don't act on what God has said to us. Tonight, just in conclusion to pray, God intends to make a specimen out of our lives. A specimen among men. A specimen among all his creatures. I bless God that several of us will rejoice in our heart today that yes, God is giving Nigeria an opportunity. As we perceive that, yes, several of our brothers are having opportunities to serve in government or the other. Yet, you see, this is the only time we can prove the devil wrong, if we become a specimen. Hallelujah. If we do something that nobody can easily discredit, if we establish a lifestyle that everybody around say, yes, these men have something that we don't have. That's when the church will be glorified. My prayer is that we will not disgrace the church at a time like this. We will not end up silencing the church because God is giving us an opportunity. Opportunity to strike our generation and say, look, this is what you should be. This is how Christians ought to behave. This is what the Word of God can produce. This is how God will do it if we give it to a child of God. I want to ask you, brother, this Word is God's comprehensive equipment for thoroughly furnishing any man for his service. How much place does he have in you? Jesus looked at some people and said, look, my word is not in you. That's why you are doing what you are doing. My word is not in you. That's why you are living the way you are living. My word is not in you. That's why you keep telling lies. My word is not in you. That's why you keep living in sin. My word is not in you. That's why you are following the pattern that you have followed. As we pray together, I see again tonight that it's an opportunity again for the seed of the truth to be cast and for deliberate step of obedience to be taken and say, Lord, I will obey you. Lord, I will do as you have said. Lord, I will not be a foolish man because storms are coming. Floods are coming. Winds will blow and it will beat upon whatever you are putting together. May he not collapse in the name of Jesus Christ. May we not be swept away. May we not be flooded out. Simply because our foundation on the Word of God is very weak. As we pray tonight, how do we apply this message? First to ourselves. Has the Word of God straightened you out? Has the Word of God reset the direction of your life? Has the Word of God been engrafted on your character? Has the Word of God been placed upon those native wisdom? That tradition you were following before, have we allowed the Word of God to produce a new species, a new specimen of the kind of man or the kind of wife that God is looking for? Your husband has been waiting to see whether what we are doing in this church is actually beneficial or not. They are waiting to discover whether the Word of God actually works or we are just joking with it. Tonight we pray again together. And as we are praying, the Lord is standing in our midst to say, yes, of his own will, begat he us again by the Word of truth. I wish you will be able to join me tonight and say, I am ready not only to hear, not only to receive, but to obey your word, to be a doer of it. I am ready to build my destiny, to build my career, to build my eternity upon the rock. And this rock is but obedience to the word of God. I wish you'll be able to join me tonight and say, Lord, send your word to my life. I will engraft it. I will cap my life with the word of God. I will never allow you to go until my life has produced the fruit that the word of God is bringing. As we pray together, and as a general introduction, all we have done tonight is a general introduction onto the matter of, you know, the pure religion that God is looking for in our midst. Tomorrow, when we now begin to look at the nitty-gritty of a Christian life that is acceptable to God. But we can't do that because there's nothing that will produce it except the word of truth. Once your attitude towards God's word has not changed, then there's nowhere any man can go in helping us. As we pray together tonight, look into your character. Look again into the recesses of your heart. Where has the word of God been? How much of it
have we acted upon? How much of it have you postponed? But Jesus is standing here. It's the same weapon he uses to change men. Paul said, I have complete confidence in the word of God, for it is the power of God for changing men. Nothing else will do it. Nothing else can genuinely bring revival except the word that is clearly taught, clearly heard, clearly received with meekness, clearly engrafted, and clearly obeyed. Shall we pray together? How many times the Lord has been speaking to you? How much have you heard from the word of God? How much have you encountered in the word of God? It is God's comprehensive implement to make a man thoroughly furnished for every kind of good work. But it only becomes effective when it is obeyed. It is the law of liberty, but until you look into it, until you persevere with it, until you act on it, it never will benefit you. Brother, sister, as we pray together, can you tell the Lord what will be your response to the word of truth? It is the word of truth that makes a man to be born again. Nothing else can plant in you the life of Christ except the word of God. Will you please let us pray together as we check what will you do with this message tonight? Let us pray. And don't pray for someone else. Just pray for yourself. I don't want to be a hearer only. I want to receive it. I want to engraft it. I want to do it. And I want to grow with it. I want to bear fruit with the word of God. That as we break out of this meeting tonight, those things that the word of God does in people's lives, God might begin to cause it to happen in your own life as well. It has brought healing to people. It has brought deliverance to people. It has brought sanctification to people. It has delivered several from sin. It has made them a different person entirely. And it has prepared them for heaven. It has taken some already to heaven. Could I ask you, what will the word of God do in your own life tonight? Can you open your mouth and discuss this as quickly as you can with the Lord who answers prayer? We are praying. We are believing God. We are trusting Him that which men cannot do, that word which produces in men the character of Christ, it will also work in your heart tonight. Father, we want to pray tonight that the power and the integrity of your word will be made manifest upon our lives. Every man that you changed, you did it by your word. Every community that experienced revival, it was by the authority of your word. Every soul that found rest, it was because they responded to the word of God and they obeyed. Every man that has been progressed and have been carried from their old levels to a new level of glory, it was because they responded to the word of truth. And everywhere the power of God broke forth, it was because you confirmed your word in the lives of those who went in obedience. Tonight, Father, we are praying. We are praying for ourselves as individuals, and we are praying corporately that our attitude towards the word of God will become correct, It will become definite. It will become effective in the name of Jesus Christ. Our Father and our God, we are praying that even tonight, that which we are hearing you say, we will not procrastinate it. Give us courage to obey you. Give us courage to do as you bid us. So that, Lord, we might become men that are blessed, men that are established, men that have good success, men whose ways have become prosperous. Lord, draw us unto the point of doing and obeying your word implicitly in the name of Jesus Christ. Holy Spirit, there would be men among us here tonight with whom you have spoken severally. They have seen your word, they have heard it many times, but they've never given it the correct response. They have always said, well, I will try. They have always given explanation for this omission. Tonight, Lord, as we pray together, we are asking that you will restore such lives and cause your word to come afresh in power, in life, in authority, to help all such men even to be established in the matter of the kingdom. Holy Spirit, we now leave this meeting to you again, that in your usual manner, you will walk among us. As we get back to our homes, you will walk in our hearts. As we go back to our places of work, your word will so work in us that it will produce in us specimens among men. That, Lord, in everything, we might be the first and the best in the name of Jesus Christ. And as we continue to pray, brothers, until you obey the word of God, until you act on the word of God, even if you promise to obey, until you have obeyed, there's no way you can sustain it. Obedience, the Bible says, is better than sacrifice. And to hearken is more better than the fat of rams. Have you disobeyed what God has said vividly to you? Have you persisted on your own permissive will rather than the word of God? Have you taken the word of God so lightly that it no longer affects your heart? Are you here tonight? Though you have heard many messages, it has never been able to change your soul. Tonight, God is asking those who hear these sayings of mine and doeth them, they are wise. But every man who hears these sayings of mine and doeth it not is a foolish man, who builds his life, builds his house, builds his destiny, builds his career on ordinary sand. When the storms come, when the floods descend, oh, it will be swept. As we pray together, I believe that the Holy Spirit has spoken to you tonight and said, yes, except you give me implicit obedience, there's nothing I can do to help your life from here. Maybe tonight you want to respond to God in complete obedience. You want to surrender completely to the Lord. You want to say, Lord, from tonight, I will no longer procrastinate action on the message I've heard. I will no longer go on half obedience. I will no longer persist. Let me surrender to your will. Lord Jesus, I want you to forgive me. I want you to help my life. And you want to make a decision. You don't want to say, well, when I get home, I will try. That is the shortest cut of forgetting all that God is saying to you. Tonight, the Holy Spirit is now speaking to you and say, tonight is your night. You must respond to my word. I would like to give you the chance to do so now. I would like you to just lift up your right hand and say, Lord, I have heard you enough. I will no longer give excuses. I will no longer disobey. I will no longer go without surrender. Lord, help me tonight. I give you that chance. If you will lift up your hand, God bless you. I've seen some hands. I believe the Lord is walking among us again. The Lord bless you. Please lift it above your head. I will want us to pray together. I will want us to commend you to God. I want us that this night that you are saying, Lord, no more half measures. No more half measures. Don't let the flood flush me out. Give me this privilege to make my life right with you. Thank you. Please stand up. Let me pray with you where you are. Thank you. The Lord bless you. And if you stand up, you don't need to raise up your hand again. You just stand up. Thank you, friends. The Lord bless you. The Holy Spirit is saying, today, if you hear his voice, harden not your heart. As it happened in the waters of Meribah. The Lord bless you. There's still some soul. The Lord is warning you. Thank you, my friend. But I want God to do it with you tonight. If there's still any person, the Lord is speaking to you. Thank you. Just stand up and stretch forth your hands towards the altar here and say, Father, tonight, I want your word to be engrafted on my soul. I want to give. The Bible says God sent forth his word and he healed them. Can you stretch forth your hand towards here again? And you are saying, Lord, for this sickness, for this infirmity, send your word to my heart and release me from this power. Can you do that just in 1 minute before we conclude? The great physician is here. You don't need to run around. His power is sufficient even to set you free and to set you on course. The Lord bless you. Father, Lord, for these hands also that are stretched because they need your touch. They need to be delivered from their infirmity. Lord, honor your word tonight. Confirm your word with signs and wonders following. Those, O Lord, who have lived in pains, we relieve them tonight and release them completely in the name of Jesus Christ. Those, Lord, who have been under the oppression of sleeplessness, the devil just comes with all forms of attack every time they close their eyes. Tonight, by the authority of your word and the authority of your name, deliver these ones in the name of Jesus Christ. Every maneuver of the devil over their lives, we bring it to a stop in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. We trust you that this extent that you are going, you will give us testimonies. Father, as we go into the new week, some of your children may travel around the federal capital. Protect your children. This week, we shall not have any emergency in the name of Jesus Christ. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in. The sun shall not smite you by day, nor the moon by night. For he that keepeth his strength, neither slumber nor sleep, the Lord will never sleep over your case. The Lord will never sleep over your matter. Those issues that you have committed to his hands, the Lord will see to it and bring it to completion in the name of Jesus Christ. The enemy will never ridicule you, but the Lord will grant you laughter in the midst of men. It was Sarah that said, the Lord has made me laugh. And all those people that will hear and see me, they will laugh with me. And tonight, the Lord will put laughter on your lips. Amen. The Lord will turn your sorrow to joy. Amen. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Those things you are pursuing over time, the Lord will bring it your way. Amen. Your hand will begin to lay hold on those things that were your possessions in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. As you obey the word of God, the word will prosper you. Amen. The Lord will make your way prosperous. Amen. And he will grant you good success. Amen. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. This week shall be a victorious week for you. Amen. This week shall be a week of advancement for your lives. Amen. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. If anything had been planned against you, if any confederacy had been called concerning you, if any weapon had been fashioned against you and against your family and against your destiny, today we nullify it in the name of Jesus Christ. We sprinkle the blood of Jesus on your path, that as you go, the covenant of the blood shall prevail over your life. It shall prevail over your children in the name of Jesus Christ. Even your children will not fall into enemy's hand. Thank you, Father. Lord, we bless you for hearing us. We know that you have heard us. We know that more than we could ask or imagine, even tonight, you will do for us. Thank you. Thank you for hearing us. In Jesus Christ's name, we have prayed. Amen. Amen. Now, please, as you stood up, once we finish sharing the grace, Pastor, you will tell us what to do. He will announce to you. You can see.
Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us now and forevermore. Amen. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever and ever. Amen.